Tasya padena vacham malam sharirasya cha vaidyakena yopakarottam pravaram muninam patanjalim pranjaliranatosmi abahu purushakaram Shankha Chakrasi Dharinam Sahasra Shirasam Shvetam Pranamami Patanjalim Hari Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsa Chanuramardhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Gurum Sarvopanishado Gavo Dugdha Gopalanandanaha Partho Vatsaha Sudhir Bhokta Dugdham Gitamritam Mahat Om Shantihi Shantihi Shantihi. So through these classes of the Bhagavad Gita, we look at the philosophical aspect of yoga. Srimad Bhagavad Gita, which is also known as Yoga Shastra, the teachings, the text on yoga by choosing every day one shloka, we try to understand the philosophical as well as the cultural context in which Raja Yoga, which is the name of the system that was conceived by Maharshi Patanjali, and later on when the masters focused more on the practice of asana and pranayama, which was just as a preparation for meditation, they started to use a specific word for that, Hatha Yoga, around in the 10th century with Gorakshanatha. So we were studying the fourth chapter and we had concluded in our previous class on Wednesday, the second verse, which was on page number 70 of this book, in which Sri Krishna said to Arjuna that sakale neha mahata yogo nashtaha parantapa, which means through a long lapse of time, slowly and slowly, this knowledge, this wisdom, which Sri Krishna had presented in the second chapter, which was knowledge as a method of experiencing unity within, and then the third chapter, which described selfless action as a means for inner purification, which then can lead towards experiencing unity, yoga in life. With the lapse of time, it became lost, or rather, even in the time of Sri Krishna, it was known to various masters, such as Maharshi Vedavyasa was there in his time, who has composed the Mahabharata, who is the author, the writer of the Bhagavad Gita. Many other great noble sages, such as Bhishma, who though despite being a prince, denied himself to become a king, though he had all the authority, all the power, but acquired this deep wisdom in his life. So it was not completely forgotten. It was there, but it became less known. So this is what Sri Krishna said in the previous shloka. Now the next one, in the third one, let us pronounce it and then we will go into its meaning, we will understand it. Sa eva,
sa eva,
sa eva,
sa eva,
sa eva,
sa eva,
ayam,
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 maya,
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 tedya,
tedya,
tedya, tedya, yogaha, 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 proktaha, 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 puratanaha, 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 bhaktosi, 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 me sakha,
me sakha,
me sakha,
me sakha,
cheti,
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 rahasyam,
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 hyetat,
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 uttamam,
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 sa evayam maya tedya yoga proktah puratanah bhaktosi me sakha cheti rahasyam hyetaduttamam. So Sri Krishna, he rekindled this wisdom. Wisdom is valid, knowledge is valid, when our minds thrill and vibrate to it. When it fails to achieve this end, new teachers have to come to arise it in our hearts, to rekindle it. This is what Sri Krishna does with Arjuna. So saevayam, indeed, it is the same wisdom that I had taught as he described, and we discussed that in great detail. He taught to Vivaswan, the god of sun, who so selflessly bestows light and life upon this planet, Maya by me, the same wisdom that I taught back then to Manu, to the forefather of humanity, the same wisdom today, Te. Te means to you, thou. Adya, today, Yogaha, the same yoga, which Shankarananda explains, the yoga which destroys the darkness of ignorance, the same yoga has been proktaha, has been explained, has been declared, has been told by me, O Arjuna, to you. This is not something new, but he says, puratanaha. Puratanaha means ancient, extremely ancient. In their utmost humbleness, all great teachers have always declared that they are not stating anything new, but are only restoring an old tradition. An eternal, which is eternal, which is eternal and is of an eternal variety, handed down from masters to pupil. This is exactly what we find in the teachings of Maharshi Patanjali. The very first verse, Atha Yoga Anushasanam. Let me reintroduce Anushasana. He does not even use the word Shasana. Shasana means to teach, and Anu means to follow. And what does that mean? After I have studied it myself from my masters, including my own mother, because his mother was a great yogini, Gonika. He's often also known as Patanjali Gonika Putra, which means Patanjali, the son of Gonika, who was a great yogini. So the wisdom that he received from his masters, he rephrased it in his own terminology, in his own words, added his own experience to it. It is this adding of his own experience which gives weight. That is what the word guru means. Guru means weight. What kind of weight? It gives weight to wisdom, to knowledge. When the master presents it from his own experience, then that wisdom which otherwise remained in books which are lifeless, but when he assimilates it by being connected to a living tradition of masters, he knows the method of assimilating it, that is when that knowledge, that wisdom becomes a living wisdom. So because the root of this knowledge is found in the Vedas, and the wisdom that has been expressed in the Vedas is considered timeless, obviously the wisdom that has been presented here is extremely, extremely ancient. What Krishna is doing, or what Patanjali does in the Yoga Sutra, what Krishna does in the Yoga Shastra, in the Bhagavad Gita, he just represents it. So the teaching that Sri Krishna is giving is just a renewal, a rediscovery, a restoration of knowledge long forgotten. This is what we find in, for example, Guruji's life. He received it from his master, great master of his time, Krishnamacharya, to whom he was directly related. He received it, he studied from him, and then further deepened his practice with the help of studying texts like the Yoga Sutras, received the deep wisdom of yoga into his life, practiced it himself, assimilated it into his practice, That is what we call yoga and swadhyaya, the going of both together. Yoga is the practical aspect and swadhyaya is studying the philosophical basis. And this is what Veda Vyasa in his commentary on the Yoga Sutras beautifully explains, that yogat swadhyayam asita. Through the practice of yoga, through practicing it yourself, enhance your understanding of what you study. So when we study the Yoga Sutras, when we study the Bhagavad Gita, when we study the Upanishads that discuss yoga, the practice that we do, what we practice, informs our study. We see the more we practice, the deeper we can go into those teachings. Swadhyayat yogam asita, and yogat swadhyayam amanit. And similarly, through studying, through listening to the experience of the masters, through first listening them, that is what we call shravana, then through critically analyzing them, which we call manana, critical analysis, logical analysis, in which questions are asked against it. If the master is present, then to the master. When the master is not present, then to oneself. And then finding those answers by contemplation, by thinking, or by practicing. And then the third thing is nididhyasana. Ultimately, after we have listened about it and we have critically analyzed it, then to experience it. That is called nididhyasana, the third stage. By doing this, we deepen our practice. And so this is the purpose of studying the Bhagavad Gita. This is why we are studying the Bhagavad Gita, so that we can go deeper within ourselves through the practice that we do, through the postures we go in. This helps us to go deeper. So swadhyaya yoga masita, with the help of swadhyaya, with the help of self-study. Swadhyaya means self-study. With the help of self-study, yoga masita, sit deeper, go deeper into the practice of yoga. And yogat, and through the practice of yoga, swadhyaya mamanet, enhance the meaning of what you study. Because when the master speaks something, there are so many layers of understanding, so many layers of meaning found within that. As a person evolves, as a person develops, he goes deeper and deeper into what the masters are trying to convey through an extremely, extremely, extremely limited medium, the words. Even though when it comes to Sanskrit, it is a highly refined language, extremely grammatical, extremely psychological, and I would say deeply scientific language, perfect to convey these deeper truths, because it was developed in this very context, and the whole terminology, the whole grammatical structure is built on these principles. So it is the most perfect medium of presenting it. But how do we go deeper? Not merely by studying grammar, not merely by studying etymology, not merely by studying various interpretation, but by finding the meaning within one's own self. So this is how the teachings of the masters and our own practice have to play, have to have a sort of interplay with each other for our development, evolvement, evolution on the path of yoga. This is what the masters say, swadhyayat yogam asita, yogat swadhyayam amanit. This is also the reason that swadhyaya has been mentioned as one of the niyamas. Niyama means, before asana, we discuss the yamas and then we discuss the niyamas. Yamas are principles which we need to obey when we interact with the society, with our environment. Niyamas are principles that we need to practice daily and regularly. Swadhyaya is one of them. We study the Bhagavad Gita once a week, but contemplation, meditation on the teaching can happen every day, and if possible, then even most of the time, whenever we have a free mind, whether we are in a posture or whether when we don't need the mind actively to engage the mind actively at a task, we can allow the mind to go back to its very source, consciousness itself. That is what the Gita is about. So yoga swadhyaya masita, swadhyaya the yoga masita, yoga swadhyaya mamanet, and then swadhyaya yoga sampatya. When a person acquires the wealth, sampatti means wealth, when a person acquires the wealth of swadhyaya and yoga, practice and understanding both, then paramatma prakashate, then the consciousness within, the pure consciousness, the supreme consciousness that resides within is revealed to the practitioner of yoga, which is the goal of the practice itself. So the teaching that we see through various masters, whether it is Guruji in modern times, it is a renewal, just a rediscovery, a restoration of knowledge in our times. This is what Krishna did, this is what the great masters of Hatha Yoga did in their times, and this is what Guruji did in our times. But why is it so? Why did I choose it to do now? This Krishna answers in the other part of the shloka, bhaktosi me. The reason is that you are devoted to me. You are deeply devoted to me. I have repeatedly stated that when Krishna speaks of I, he does not mean the name and the form that is standing in front of Arjuna. But when he refers, when he uses the word I, like all the masters in the Vedic traditions, the I refers to the very core of one's being. As a person starts asking this question that who am I? And when the answer is experienced, when the answer is revealed, that I is what is meant by the masters when they use the word I. And this becomes nowhere clearer than in this example. Krishna says that because you are deeply devoted to me. First of all, this emphasizes the significance of the path of bhakti yoga, the path of love and devotion as a means to acquire that knowledge which Sri Krishna emphasizes again and again, that bhaktiya tvananyaya labhyaha. Through knowledge, I can be understand. So bhakti yoga as a means, whether it is Patanjali when he speaks of Ishvara pranidhana, complete surrender to that universal consciousness, different words, but they mean the same thing. So first of all, this becomes clear. The second thing which I would like to clarify here, and which will also help us to look at some of the traditions that have developed yoga, is that interestingly, Arjuna, if you look at the whole story of Mahabharata, he only saw Krishna as a friend. He was not a devotee in that sense. Even though Krishna says, you are deeply devoted to me. But he did not know who Krishna was. He was very fond of him. They deeply liked each other. They had a very strong friendship. But in his ignorance, he did not understand the essential nature of Krishna. He regrets that in the 11th chapter after the essential nature of Krishna is revealed to him. But Arjuna was not a devotee of Krishna. Arjuna was not even a devotee of Vishnu, of whom Krishna is considered in Hinduism an incarnation. He was not even a devotee of Vishnu. He was a devotee of Shiva. And this is what we find repeatedly stated in Mahabharata during his time when he had to live in the forest. Arjuna had gone on top of a mountain and meditated for a year, for a complete year, on Shiva. So he was a Shiva devotee. He performed austerity in the Himalayas to get a vision of Shiva. So he was a devotee of Shiva. He was not a devotee of Krishna. Then how does Krishna state that because you are deeply devoted to me? Shankarananda, a great commentator of, I think, around the 10th century, 1,000 years ago, who gives, his commentary has unfortunately not yet been translated on the Bhagavad Gita into English. But when we speak of Sanskrit traditional commentaries, we always we speak of these three major commentaries. The first one is Shankaracharya's commentary, which is a commentary just to hear, just to listen. Then we have the 15th century Madhusudan Saraswati, who is considered a great scholar. His commentary is an analytical commentary. And then the third one is Shankarananda, who speaks from his own experience. It is an experiential commentary. He emphasizes, he emphasizes the oneness of Shiva and Vishnu, which is central to the philosophy of yoga, to the understanding of yoga, to the religious aspect of yoga. Because on one side, in the Raja Yoga tradition, we find the deity that is being worshipped is Vishnu. And it is essentially a Vaishnava tradition, while Hatha Yoga, the Natha Yogis, they were worshippers of Lord Shiva. It was a Shaiva tradition. But in a sense, these are just two different names, two different forms. This has been repeatedly expressed by the masters. Shankarananda quotes the scriptures and says that Yatha Shiva Mayo Vishnu, like Vishnu in his totality consists of Shiva, evam Vishnu Maya Shivaha. Shiva in his totality consists of Vishnu. They just seem two different forms, two different names, but in reality, Shivasya Hridayam Vishnu, the heart of Shiva is in Vishnu, and Vishnuscha Hridayam Shivaha, and the heart of Vishnu is in Shiva. So even though the philosophy of yoga was developed in two very different traditions in which there were tremendous sectarian differences, these differences never caused division in the deeper understanding, because again and again, that unity, that oneness, even though today we refer to Hinduism as if it's one religion. No. The Vaishnava traditions are as different from say the Shaiva traditions or the Shakta traditions, as different as Islam is from Christianity or Islam is from Judaism. That is how different they are. Actually, Vaishnavism, Shaivism and Shaktism, they are religions within Hinduism itself. Complete religions within Hinduism itself. But this sectarian difference never became a cause of division. So Arjuna himself, as a great devotee of Lord Shiva, was aware of this fact, and in his prayer to Lord Shiva, when he meditated in the Himalayas, this was many years or a few years before the Srimad Bhagavad Gita was spoken to him. He states this in his prayer, Shivaya Vishnu Rupaya, I meditate upon you, O Shiva, who exist in the form of Vishnu, and I meditate upon you, O Vishnu, who you exist in the form of Shiva. Shivaya Vishnu Rupaya, Vishnave Shiva Rupini. And to further emphasize this unity between, because the problem is that when we choose a form and a name for the sake of practicing dharana, for the sake of training our mind to focus on one object, some traditions choose one name, one form, the other tradition chooses a different name and a different form. And then the problem arises that one emphasizes on this name and the other emphasizes. This story everybody knows. We see this story happening in every religion, and that's why this clash is happening. But as a person goes deeper, then the essence that is being presented through that symbolical presentation, that is one and the same. And to express that even on the symbolical level, at least in the Indian tradition, a lot of synthesis was emphasized again and again in the prayers, in the scriptures, even in the mythological representation. So for example, if you have ever visited Himachal Pradesh, which is a state higher up in the Himalayas, it's a Himalayan state. It borders to Tibet, and Kullu Manalis are famous tourist destinations in that state. Near Kullu Manali, there is a very holy place where thousands and thousands, I should say, hundreds of thousands and millions of pilgrims visit this place. It is rather unknown amongst Western tourists, even though just a place called Kasol, I think, is highly popular with Israeli tourists, just a few kilometers before Manikaran, but very few people end up visiting Manikarnika Tirtha, which is popularly known as Manikarana, where there is hot water. There are hot water springs. Why there are hot water springs? Because it is the union of water and fire. Fire is the destructive force and water is the sustaining force. Vishnu is the sustaining force in this universe and Shiva is the destructive force. So this is where Shiva and Vishnu, so to say, in nature come together. And that is why that Tirtha, that sacred place, is also sometimes referred to as Harihara Tirtha. Tirtha, a sacred place where Hari, which means Lord Vishnu, and Hara, Lord Shiva, they came together, they became united. And even in art, if you just Google Harihara, you will see beautiful ancient statues and modern pictures of a man, I should say, a man half like Shiva and half like Vishnu. On one side, it's one person, but on one side, he's depicted like Shiva, on one side he's depicted like Vishnu. So all these methods to express that these powers are manifestations, whether it is the creative power, the sustaining power, or the destructive power, all these three powers are manifestations of the same entity. To emphasize that, to explain that, of the same divinity. So it has been done through so many different ways. Otherwise, it is funny that some people even fight over names. For example, the devotees of Shiva say that Haridwara should be called Haradwara. Hara means the door to Hara, because it's the place where a person started his journey to reach Kedarnath. So for Shaivas, for the devotees of Shiva, it is Haradwara. And for the devotees of Vishnu, it is Haridwara.
Haridwara means the door to Hari, the door to the sacred place of Vishnu, which is Badrinath. And similarly in Rishikesh, we also, if you look at the ancient history of this place, the temple that lies in the city center now, from which the name arised, Rishikesh, the form of Lord Vishnu. It's a very ancient temple. You must visit it once. It was repeatedly broken and then reconstructed. It's an extremely ancient temple, Rishikesha. Rishika actually means senses, and Isha means Lord, the Lord of the senses. So yogis came here to practice pratyahara, to practice control over their senses. So they worshipped the divinity with a name as a Lord of the senses. The name also occurs in the Bhagavad Gita, frequently used for Shri Krishna. So that is a Vishnu temple. You go less than a kilometer, a little bit out of Rishikesh, and you reach this locality which is known Virabhadra. There you find extremely ancient temples dedicated to Lord Shiva, excavated sites by Archaeological Survey of India. Both areas in Rishikesh have been extremely important. But these differences never divided. These sectarian differences never became a cause of division. And I think this union has no more been further emphasized than in one of the foremost sacred places in India, known as Rameshwara. Every Hindu tries to visit in his life, at least. He tries to visit these four temples in the four directions of India. In the north, it is Badrinath. In the west, it is Dwarika. In the east, it is Jagannath Puri. And in the south, it is Rameshwaram. Rama means Lord Rama, and Ishwara means Lord. And it is a temple. It's not a temple of Rama. It's a temple of Shiva. Because the legend goes that before he embarked on his journey to Sri Lanka, to conquer the king of Sri Lanka, he worshipped Lord Shiva at that place, constructed a beautiful Shivalingam there, which is over which the present temple has been constructed. So it's an extremely holy place. But what is the meaning of the word Rameshwaram? The masters question themselves, what does it mean? Grammatically, it can be interpreted in three different ways. The first they went to Lord Rama because he had installed the statue, he had installed the Shivalingam there. So they asked him, you gave this name Rameshwaram, what does it mean? Lord Rama said, it means the Lord of Rama. Because Shiva is my Lord, I worshipped him here, he is my Lord, he is my divinity, my preferred form of the divine. I worshipped him here, therefore I called him Rameshwara. Then the masters went to Shiva. They asked him, what Rama said, what does Rameshwara mean to you? He said, for me Rameshwara means the person of whom Rama is the Lord, which means Shiva. Yes, it is my name, and it means because I worship Lord Rama, I meditate upon him, he is my Lord, therefore it is called Rameshwara. Now the masters were confused that they both are giving very opposing explanations of this word. So then they came up with the third grammatical construction, which says Rama and Ishvara, which means Shiva, are both one and the same. So this is what Rameshwara ultimately means. So because of such teachings, it's difficult a little bit to explain in English because it depends on the grammatical structure of this Sanskrit word. But through these teachings, the masters help us to keep aware of the deep inner truth which is found uniformly expressed through all these different names and forms that the masters have chosen. So bhaktosi, so whether Shri Arjuna is a devotee of Shiva, when Shri Krishna says that you are deeply devoted to me, he is not referring to his particular name or to his particular form, but he means that pure inner consciousness which was being worshipped by Arjuna in the form of Shiva. But ultimately it was the same entity that existed within Arjuna himself and within Krishna himself. Then the second thing comes. You are deeply devoted to me. And then sakha cheti, because you are my friend. You are my eternal companion. This is the second reason. Therefore, rahasyam hetad uttamam, I have revealed the supreme secret. Rahasya is a word that in Sanskrit actually means something that should only be spoken in rahas. And rahas means when there are only two people, just between the master and the student. That is where the communion, the real communion, takes place. And the communion which takes place, that is called rahasya. We translate it as the word secret. That is, I suppose he might have translated, which is a supreme secret. Rahasya simply means that which is fit to be spoken and explained between two. This is also the meaning of the word Upanishad. So, what is so secret about the friendship of Krishna with Arjuna? Because the Mahabharata story is a deeply symbolical story, what is this friendship between? It symbolizes the friendship between the individual self, which we refer to the Jivatman in Sanskrit, with the universal self. And this friendship is a theme that we not only find in Mahabharata, but we find it in all the ancient Vedic texts, in the Upanishads. So we find it in the Vedas, the quintessence of which are the Upanishads. We find it in the Upanishads, which in more detail express the philosophy of yoga. Even the concept of asana, even though it was developed by the 10th century Natha yogis, it has its origin in Shvetashvatara Upanishad, one of the Upanishads. It has been mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita as well. So all these texts refer to this eternal companionship between the individual self and the universal self through different words, through different names, and through different forms. In the Rig Veda, which is the most ancient text of India and also the most sacred and therefore also the most secret text, secret scripture, the very foundational text which lies at the very origin of everything that is spiritual, everything that spiritual came into existence in the subsequent centuries. There we find this mantra, Indrasya Yujyaha Sakha, Vishnu. That Vishnu simply means, Vish means to enter and Vish means to envelop. So Vishnu is the entity which is entered into everything and which envelops everything. The omnipresent entity, the omnipresent consciousness. That is what the word Vishnu means, the universal self. And his sakha is translated as the word friend, companion, is Indra there. And what does Indra mean? Indra means the one who sees this creation, the world. This we find beautifully explained in one of the Upanishads, which the inquiry starts with Atha Kohamiti, then who am I? And then when he experiences the consciousness within, the master names it Idandra. Idandra means, Idam means this, and Dra means to see. And the one, the entity, the consciousness that sees within us, that is referred to by the word Indra. So, Indrasya, and then beautifully, the word Yujya has been used, which is the same word that lies at the root of the word Yoga, fit to be united. Those that need to be united. Indrasya Yujya Sakha. Those that need ultimately, eventually to come together. So the friendship of Indra and Vishnu that we find being mentioned in the Rig Veda and the story of the Mahabharata shows us, tells us how Arjuna is an incarnation of Indra and Shri Krishna is an incarnation of Vishnu. So their friendship expresses exactly the same truth that has been expressed in the Vedic teachings through the friendship of Indra and Vishnu. And in this context, we cannot forget a story in the ancient Vedas which is extremely similar and which explains what kind of friendship this is. When Vritra means that which covers, that the veil of ignorance, the veil of darkness. When Indra tries to destroy it, tries to annihilate it, he's not able to do it himself. Why is it so? Now this takes us to ancient mythology. If you look at the pictures of Mitra, you find a thunderbolt in his hand. This is exactly the same like the Zeus of the ancient Greeks, who was bearing a thunderbolt. And actually Zeus, pater of Greek, is the Dyaush Pitha of the Vedas. The concept has an extremely same origin. It becomes very clear of both ideas in amongst the ancient Greeks and amongst ancient Hindus. However, this thunderbolt that he bears in his hand has been explained as tapas. Tapas, which is what Patanjali refers in the very beginning of the second chapter, Tapah Swadhyaya Ishvara Pranidhanani Kriya Yoga. When he explains Kriya Yoga, the first thing that he states is tapas, voluntary hardship, austerity, taking voluntary hardship upon oneself for the sake of purification. It is this tapas, this heat that generates as a result of practice and as a result of practicing yoga, that is what that thunderbolt symbolizes. But when Indra was unable to lift that thunderbolt to destroy Vritra, to destroy the demon of ignorance, he had to take the strength for to do that from Vishnu. And this story, I think, beautifully presents that an individual self, unless he derives the strength from that universal self by completely surrendering itself to that, the strength, and that is why Patanjali, Shraddha, first he speaks of deep faith, deep devotion, which then according to him leads to virya, strength. So this strength in the yogic understanding, which then enables a person to practice and go deeper into one's own self. That strength comes from there. The source of strength lies there. That is referred to as Vishnu. Sometimes the Vedas refer to them as two birds living on the same tree, Dvasuparna, two beautiful birds, Sayuja, who are deeply united with each other, Sakhaya, are friends of each other, Samanam Rikram Parishaswajate, and live on the same tree, this body which is like an upside down tree. The roots are up here, this is the stem and the branches. These two birds live in the same tree. Tayuranyaha pippalam swadvatti. One of them, he tastes the fruits in this life. Anashnanyo abhijakashiti. The other one just remains a pure witness. So sometimes the Vedas speak of this eternal companionship of both as two birds. This also we find the same in the Upanishads. In modern India, we worship this companionship as the concept of Nara Narayana. Nara means human being, and Narayana means the abode of humanity. Humanity and the abode of humanity as both together. In fact, the prayer that a person usually pronounces before studying the Mahabharata, of which Srimad Bhagavad Gita is a part, is a prayer to Narayanam Namaskritya. First of all, after prostrating to the abode of all humanity, Naram Chaiva Naruttamam, and then prostrating to humanity itself. So it starts by prostrating to the universal self and the individual self. They are known as Nara and Narayana. And if you look at, if you have traveled in the state of Gujarat, and if you have visited these beautiful temples of the Narayana, Swami Narayana tradition, you will always see, you don't see one deity there, you will see two deities there. And one is Nara and one is Narayana. So this eternal companionship, eternal friendship between the individual self and the universal self has inspired this tradition known as the Swaminarayana tradition. When you travel, the place which is very sacred in this area, Badrika Ashrama, Badrinath, 300 kilometers in the north, is considered sacred because both Nara and Narayana, both according to the legends, performed austerity there. And even today, when we visit the place, the priests show these two mountains up there and they call them Nara and Narayana. These two mountains up there, they symbolize Nara and Narayana. So it comes back to this eternal companionship, eternal togetherness of these two entities. But are they really two? That is the biggest question. Are they really two? No. Suparnam vipraha kavayo vachobhihi ekam santam bahudha kalpayanti. That bird in reality is one, even though it is one. Ekam santam, even though it is one. When the masters express it, they express it in various ways. And why? This is what the Gita tries to explain in its teachings, that as the universal consciousness reflects in the mind, it creates a reflection. Like the sun, when it reflects in a mirror, it creates this reflection. These two things seem completely different from each other. One is the reflection in the mirror, extremely small, extremely tiny, extremely little, with only a little bit of light, with only a little bit of warmth. Yet its origin lies in that. They are ultimately one and the same. There is no difference between both. And therefore, the Mahabharata, again, in another place, comes back to this idea and says, Atma hi Krishna bhartasya. Krishna is the very self of Arjuna, and Krishnasya Atma Dhananjayaha, and Arjuna is the very self of Krishna. So they are both one and the same. So what is Krishna in fact? Krishna is our potential. He is what we want to become through the practice of yoga. Therefore he is called Yogeshwara, the Lord of Yoga. He is our true divine nature, transcending our own limited nature. When we have transcended our own limited nature, what we become, that is what we are referring to by the word Krishna. Krishna is nothing but our own self transcending our limited self. It is our own unlimited self, limitless self, infinite self, after the limiting self has been transcended. He is what we actually are if we remove the darkness or veil or the limiting adjunct of ignorance and its effects, ego, attachment, hatred, fear, etc., referred to by Patanjali as klesha. In short, Krishna is nothing but our better self. This is the meaning of the two birds abiding in the same tree. When the mantra there says that because one tastes the fruits, he is plunged into misery. The other one remains a witness. When this one also experiences his witness, his nature of being a pure witness, then they become one. They become same in nature. Then there is no distinction anymore left between both. I think when Bible, for example, speaks that God created man in his own image, in the image of God created he him. I think in my understanding, in the understanding of Vedanta, this is how it would be explained. With the example of a mirror and the sun. Ultimately, the masters, the commentators explain that what is a friend? What does a friend mean? What does the word sakha in Sanskrit mean? Ahite pratishedhascha. A friend is someone who stops us from doing something that will be harmful for us. Such a person is called a friend. That is the first definition. Ahite pratishedhascha. Someone, if we can't see that this is harmful, our friend tells us, don't do this. This is harmful. He or she protects us from that. That is the first definition. And then hite chaiva pravartanam, whatever he or she thinks to be beneficial for us, he inspires us to do that, to follow that. Hite chaiva pravartanam, he inspires us to do what is hita, what is beneficial for us. Vyasane cha parityagaha, and if at some point in life, a moment comes when we are completely lost, when we don't know to whom to go, where to find help, when we become completely lost, a person, a friend, is a person to whom we can go, to whom we can resort. A friend is a person who would never leave our hand even in the most tough moments. Ahite pratishedhascha, someone who stops us from going into the wrong direction, inspires us to go into the right direction, and never leaves our side when tough moments come in our life. Vyasane chaiva parityaga, trividham sakhi lakshanam. This is the definition of the word sakha. The pure self within all of us, of which the masters wish us to become aware of, which is there but we remain unaware of it. which has been presented here through the friendship of Krishna and Arjuna. This is that kind of friend. Because Shri Krishna, he stops Arjuna from going into the wrong direction. He inspires him to follow the proper path. And whenever tough times came on Shri Krishna, on Arjuna, Shri Krishna was always standing there, was always helping there. So Bhaktosi, you are deeply devoted to me, and Sakhacheti, and you are my very close friend. Rahasyam Hetad Uttamam. This is a great secret. Either it can be interpreted in both ways, that you are my devotee and you are my best friend. This is a deep secret, and I tried to explain a little bit the philosophical basis between this relationship of Lord and devotee and this relationship of friendship. Therefore, when we speak of bhakti, there are many types of bhaktis, many types of devotions. One of them is sakya, to have a relationship of friendship with the divine, and dasya. Another type is dasya, in which to have a relationship of master and servant. In most religions, I think we only find this relationship, the dasya relationship, the relationship between a devotee and a servant and God. But the Vedic traditions, when they speak of bhakti yoga, when they speak of deep devotion, then they speak of 9 different types of relationships with that supreme divinity. However, the time is over, so let us conclude the shloka with this. Now, we can, in our next class, we can start by studying the question of Arjuna, after which Shri Krishna once again, because originally the teaching of the Bhagavad Gita was finished in the 2nd and the 3rd chapter, but once again Shri Krishna, after seeing how ignorant he is, after seeing that he did not understand what Krishna means by I, he starts again with a new discourse, which we will find in the rest of the Bhagavad Gita. So let us conclude with a short meditation and a prayer for universal well-being. Sarve bhavantu sukhinah, sarve santu niramayah, sarve bhadrani pashyantu, ma kashchit dukha bhag bhavet. Om shantihi, shantihi, shantihi.